honor, duty, and respect. These are the three core values that are instilled into every young man and woman who decides to enlist into the Citadel Corps of Cadets. Not only do these values stand as the pillars to the Citadel's rich history and evolution, they stand as the guiding principles that these individuals will carry with them throughout the rest of their lives. For any civilian who comes out Citadel campus and just takes a walk around, they will bear witness to the living example of principled leadership and service. Through all of these individuals have earned their place in the Corps. I want to welcome everybody this morning to this tour. My name is Andrew Kuhn. I'm a historian and tour guide with Bulldog Tours, and it is an honor and a privilege to be able to come to you this morning and to provide this brand new tour that we have entitled The Soul of the Citadel. And for anyone out there that has watched the video that Tom Laverne did just a few days ago, he talked about that at the end of last year, we had this opportunity presented to us from the Citadel about creating a tour. There's never been a tour like this at the Citadel campus. There's been, you know, buses that have come through or heard little brief clippets and things about the history of this school. But we decided that we were going to piece together a tour that wouldn't just be for people that were looking to become students here or even for alumni. It would be for anybody. It would be for visitors, even locals that would love to know more about the campus and the school's just amazing history. And so that's what we pieced together. And the full tour encompasses about an hour and a half to 2 hours worth of time, but we felt it may be a little bit too long to do on a Facebook Live video. So we've cut it down. We're going to do just about a 45-minute tour today, hitting all the highlights of the tour itself. And then at the end, we'll do a little question and answer. So anyone out there that has any questions or answers or any questions about anything we talk about, anything about the Citadel, I will be more than happy to answer those questions when we get down to the end. And so to begin, we are going to head over to the main administrative building called Bond Hall. And so if you will, follow me and let's head this way. So as you can see, as we're walking up, this is Bond Hall. It is actually named for Oliver James Bond. Oliver James Bond was actually the first president of the Citadel. He was the president in the early 20th century, and a lot of the major changes that happened at the Citadel campus, we can actually contribute back to this individual. Oliver Bond, a lot of smaller things, and then of course a lot of major changes. From a smaller side, I mentioned he was the first president. When he was hired, he was actually hired to be the superintendent of the school, but he decided that he wanted to change his own title. So he went from superintendent to president. So that's why we often say to people that he was the last superintendent of the college and he was the first president of the college. Another major change that he did was he actually gave the Citadel its name. Before Oliver Bond, this was actually referred to as the Citadel Academy. The problem with the word academy at that time was a term more so used for primary and secondary education, not really for a higher place of learning like this. And so he actually was the one who instituted that it would be called the Citadel, the Military College of South Carolina. But probably one of the most largest changes that he made is actually to where we are right now. The original Citadel campus was actually located right in the heart of the peninsula, adjacent to Marion Square. However, it had grown too small. The school was growing, more and more students were coming in, and so there happened to be some land out here on the banks of the Ashley River. And so he has contributed for the second campus and the campus that we're here today. And one of the first structures actually built was Bond Hall that we're standing in front of right now. But the first mention of the Citadel in Charleston in its history actually has nothing to do with where we are. It has nothing to do with the Citadel, the school, anything like that. In fact, it was not a mention of the Citadel, it was a mention of a Citadel. In 1822, a free person of color by the name of Denmark Vesey was planning for a uprising of the enslaved people in Charleston. And the uprising never actually took place. He was caught beforehand. And so out of that, a fear among the state of South Carolina of another uprising, that the state decided to institute and build two arsenals in the state itself that would stock a lot of guns and ammunition. One was the arsenal and was located in Columbia, South Carolina. But to distinguish it, the one they built here in Charleston, they referred to as a fortress, a citadel, if you will. And so it was actually completed 7 years after that uprising. So in 1829 was when it actually opened up. And who occupied it for the first time? Federal troops. Federal troops that were actually stationed over at Fort Moultrie were actually sent over to help garrison it. The problem at that time was that South Carolina was right in the midst of the nullification crisis in the country. An ongoing battle with President Andrew Jackson about nullifying a lot of federal laws that were coming out at the time. And the locals of Charleston did not like the idea of federal troops occupying a building stockaded with a lot of guns and ammunition. So they requested the removal of the federal troops and to be replaced with a state militia. Well, what came in was called the Municipal Guard. And the Municipal Guard, at best, were ill-prepared soldiers. These were people with no military background, no training, and they would rather partake in things like drunkenness and licentious behavior. And they provided a stain and kind of a problem for the city of Charleston. And so under Governor Johnson, the idea came around is to actually take these two places, the arsenal in Columbia and the citadel in Charleston, and to make them a place for people to come, for students to learn not only a military discipline, but to ingrain that with traditional subjects at that time. And so getting a charter in 1842, on March the 20th of 1843, 20 cadets walked into the Citadel campus, 14 into the arsenal. And that day is immortalized to this day, every March 20th, called Corps Day. And so for the first couple of years, they remained the two institutions. However, in 1845, they decided to combine them. And what would happen is that all of the fourth year, the freshmen, would actually attend the Arsenal Academy in Columbia, and then they would finish out their careers in the Citadel here in Charleston. And again, that campus was located over but Mary. That building is actually still there. It's used as an Embassy Suites hotel today, but you can go out there and still see the original Citadel structure. The first graduating class of the Citadel was in 1846, and that was right in the midst of the Mexican-American War. So not only did you have cadets that went and enlisted to fight, but they also trained the 1st South Carolina Infantry Unit, a regiment that became known as the Palmetto Regiment. And in fact, when Mexico City fell, it was the flag of the Palmetto Regiment to fly first over that city. And those were the early years of the institution that we're at today. And so with that, we're going to take a walk across the street and go talk a little bit about another major point of the Citadel's history. So as we walk up, you'll notice around the Citadel's campus, there's a lot of different monuments. One of the ones that I find the most important is the one that you're looking at right now, which is actually a monument dedicated to the Star of the West, and actually an award that is given yearly, to one of the cadets here at the campus. Now, the Star of the West is actually the name of a ship going back to the Civil War. In 1860, the boiling point between North and South was actually right on the cusp. And on December 20th of 1860, South Carolina became the first state to secede from the Union. And so a few Major Robert Anderson, who was actually in charge of federal troops over at Fort Moultrie, whilst a lot of Charlestonians holidays under the guise of darkness, he wanted to take his troops to somewhere where they can be better defended. And it just so happened there was an unfinished fort sitting right in the middle of the harbor that he felt would be the best defensive position, a place called Fort Sumter. And so when Fort Sumter, they arrived, of course, word got back to Columbia, our capital, and in South Carolina basically decided to send Citadel cadets to Morris Island. And Morris Island, they were to establish a battery as a defensive position in case if the battle was, the war was to break out. And going into January, you have to consider that the president was still James Buchanan. Now, he had already lost the presidency to Abraham Lincoln, so he was in that lame duck period. There was nothing that he was really going to do, and he did not want the war to start under his presidency. The problem that Robert Anderson had on this small little island of Fort Sumter was he couldn't get any supplies. And so he was petitioning for more supplies to come in to stand a better defensive position. And James Buchanan decided that basically he was going to very quietly send down just merchant ships to help kind of supply the fort. Well, very quietly one night, he sent a ship out of New York Harbor called the Star of the West as a merchant ship to come and to restock Fort Sumter. And so as that ship started to approach, the Citadel cadets under Major Peter Stevens, who was the superintendent of the college at the time, he saw this, and so what he ordered was some warning shots against the Star of the West. And the captain of the Star of the West, it was basically a game of chicken, who was gonna blink first. And so the captain of the Star of the West decided, he made an order. He said, I want you to lower the flag, and I want you to raise an even larger one. And I want you to full steam it ahead to Fort Sumter. And at that time, that was considered an act of aggression. And so Major Stevens, he had a big decision to make because the entire weight of his of the world was on that gentleman's shoulders. And so he finally made the order and he told his cadets to open fire. And so 17 shots rang out in rapid succession. But these cadets had never really practiced firing that type of weapon against a moving target out in the harbor. So of the 17, only three of them actually reached their target. No one died, and it didn't destroy the ship. But it was enough for the captain of the Star of the West to turn tail and to head back to the Charleston Harbor, or to the New York Harbor, rather. Now, oftentimes, when you study history, when you study American history, especially the time of the Civil War, a lot of people are very much aware that the Civil War first shots fired at Fort Sumter in April of 1861, and this was 3 months prior to that. While the war gets credited for starting a little bit later, what happened that day is, of course, going to ignite a powder keg to becoming the worst war that the United States have ever been involved in. Today, the Star of the West Memorial is an award given out after a very rigorous competition among these cadets. And when the person who wins gets the title of the best drilled cadet, and they actually get a medal, and inside that medal is a little shard of the original Star of the West ship. And so with that, I want to take you over and let's talk a little bit about the cadets themselves, what it is to be a cadet at the Citadel campus. So as we start to walk, I will say that at the Citadel, in the very early years, they didn't use terms like freshman, sophomore, junior, senior. Today, much more so. But instead, they were referred to fourth year, third year, second year, and first year students. Fourth year freshmen, first year up to the seniors. And, you know, there is, of course, very similar elements to other colleges, but they don't stay in dorms. Instead, cadets sleep and stay in barracks. There are five barracks at the Citadel campus, and we are right now coming up to what's called Law Barracks. And Law Barracks is 3rd Battalion here at Law Barracks. And the design is that you'll notice, of course, everyone kind of says that all of this architecture falls into a very castle looking. Well, the specific type of architecture would be categorized as Romanesque. And all the barracks is a basic four-wall design. Instead of having floors, when you look at it, it's actually broken down into divisions. And so as you see, of course, the four divisions, and then at every side, there is an entry and exit point. However, the main one that we're looking at right now is called Main Port, and then the three adjacent are referred to as the Sally Ports. We can't go in. We are going to take a step inside and kind of show you exactly what it's like to be inside the barracks. Oh, to the doorway. I'm sorry. Not inside. In the doorway. But when you divide up the core is actually divided first and foremost by battalion, and that is given a numerical number. So 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th, and 5th battalion. And so 5 barracks, 5 battalions. And like I said, this is 3rd battalion. And once you actually separate it by battalion, it then goes into companies. Instead of a numerical value for the company, they're given an alphabetical. There is 4 companies per battalion. And so right here, we actually have I, K, L, and M companies. And of course, instead of referring to, they often just say India, Kilo, Lima, or Mike companies. And so those 4 are located in 3rd battalion. The companies are then further subdivided into 3 platoons. Each platoon. And so just like any military institution, you're going to have that very rigid structure and organization at a place like the Citadel. When any cadet comes in for the very first time, they walk in and assign randomly to one of those companies. And the first year, they are not referred as freshmen. That is called the NOB year, K-N-O-B, NOB. And when the NOBs come in, they are going to undergo a year-long process of being challenged both physically and mentally. And all of it is to prepare them into a position of leadership, because the leadership skills that they're going to learn are things like discipline. They're going to learn, one of the most valuable things you can ever learn, self-awareness, right? But the 4-year leadership model at the Citadel is based on the fact that your freshman year is about preparing. Your second year is about engaging. Third year, your junior year, is about serving. And then your senior year is finally taking on that leadership position. And so as a NOB comes in on day one, of course, they're going to get that very famous NOB haircut where their heads get completely shaved. They're going to be given uniforms. They're going to be given their rifle. They're going to go through an academic orientation. But they're also going to get introduced into military discipline. And when we think about this, and for anyone out there that's never gone through it, you may think about, military discipline being how to handle a weapon, how to properly salute, how to drill, all of those things, absolutely true. But they're also going to learn things like how to make their beds, how to shine their shoes, all of that make a good soldier. And so the first week is always going to be the toughest week on any of them. And a lot of times, if you ask any cadet, what was probably the scariest thing about the Citadel was probably that unknown about that first week, those first days coming in, not knowing what was going to happen. And so that first week is called Hell Week, because it really just kind of gets you inundated into the process of what you're going to go through. In fact, if you ever walk around the Citadel campus, you'll always identify the NOBs, because they have to maintain a pace at 120 steps per minute. So they're walking always a lot faster than everybody else. As it comes to the NOB year, like I said, it's a lot of rigorous and physical challenges. At one point, it was often referred to as a form of discipline that was called racking. Because when you think about who is disciplining these NOBs, it's not the professors. It's not what you see in movies of older guys that are drilled. It's coming from the upperclassmen. The upperclassmen are the ones that actually drill them the hardest. And the process of racking can be anything, pulling the rifles over their heads, running in place, while they're typically answering questions. Questions all about the corps, about the Citadel, their platoon, their squads, the company, anything. And so, interesting story is that back in the early 80s, the Citadel mandated that you could not rack a NOB for longer than 15 minutes. And a local, one of the upperclassmen figured out that the song Rapper's Delight by Sugar Hill Gang was exactly 15 minutes. So they would turn on that song, and when the song was over, they knew they had to stop with the discipline. So through operant conditioning, a lot of those NOBs associated that song with being disciplined, and maybe still resonates today. And as you can imagine, there are moments when these NOBs want to get retribution. They try to get some revenge on the upperclassmen. Doesn't always go over well. I think one of the best stories that I found was back in the 1960s. One of the NOBs actually went into an upperclassman's room, one of the upperclassmen that was giving him a little bit harder of a time. And what he decided to do was to take 10 pounds of flour and just to dust the upperclassman's room. So he goes in, he dusts the entire room, and thinking that he's gotten away scot-free, how in the world is he ever going to get caught? Well, the upperclassmen found him very quickly after he simply followed the footprints of Flower back to the Knob's bedroom. So things like that, of course, do take place. But when you, for anybody there that, of course, has gone through the Knob system, if you're a local of Charleston, if you've been here for a long time, you are very much aware of the Knob year. And you've probably heard a lot of stories, a lot of rumors is exactly what it's like. It is a system that throughout its existence has been ridiculed, it has been mocked, it's been criticized and debated, it's been feared. But for anyone that's actually gone through it, it is a rite of passage. And they wear it as a badge of honor. And if you talk to anybody that has gone through it and any alumnus out there today, many of them will tell you that some of their best memories of this place came from that first year, from that Knob year of being a cadet. So we're going to take a walk, and as we start to head in this direction, my camera woman behind me, she's going to take a look out here at to the parade ground, and of course really seeing the central point of the Citadel campus. You know, when the Citadel was created, the first major disciplines, military disciplines that were instilled were artillery and infantry. And with Marion Square directly next to the Citadel, they would go out and they would perform all their drills out in Marion Square. And they would actually do this 5 days a week. Monday through Friday, they would have their drills. People would go out and watch them. It was very, very common. They never drilled on the weekend. Saturday was always for room inspections, and Sunday was for chapel. Regardless, when they actually moved campuses, that has continued on. So they still continue to drill out here, and in fact, on Fridays throughout the year, they have their parades. And again, they're open to the public. I think John mentioned those on Wednesday, that you can come out and you can actually watch them. And as he mentioned, a lot of the cadets, not always the funnest thing to do, but they're really, really interesting to see. Not only is the parade deck used for those drilling exercises and whatnot, but they've had events out here. As John mentioned, that his uncle, great uncle, actually landed a Cessna out here at one point to bring Santa Claus to the cadets at Christmas time. But another interesting tidbit goes back to 1975. In 1975, there was an up-and-coming artist, musician. He only had about one kind of big hit at the time, and he was asked to come and perform a concert. And he performed the concert right out here on the parade deck. Well, after the concert, he received a letter basically telling him that he was no longer welcome back at the Citadel. And the big reason why is that his lyrics were too raunchy, too ostentatious, a lot of different words you can use. And so that artist actually has said that he took that letter and framed it because he was just so proud of it. That artist was Jimmy Buffett. And so Jimmy Buffett was the one who was asked never to return to the Citadel campus. And it remains that way today. He is still banned from the campus. In addition to that, of course, not only concerts, but you've had speeches, you know, different sides of the political spectrum from people running for president have come out to the Citadel to use it again and using the parade ground to give speeches as well. But just like any other institution, you know, the Citadel has definitely evolved in a lot of different ways, especially during the 20th century. There was unprecedented times that the Citadel saw. And, you know, one, of course, was the big ones, was the Great Depression. It was through the leadership of the president, Charles Summerall, at the time, that helped actually navigate through the Great Depression. And that is why the chapel that was built, or get started to be built during his time, is actually named the Summerall Chapel. And that is actually straight in front that Lisa is showing the camera on right now. It stands as a non-denominational chapel, and so they do have different services from Catholic, Protestant Episcopal services inside that chapel on a weekly basis. But another couple other major changes that occurred, of course, was civil rights. And during the era of civil rights, of course, a lot of schools, especially in the Deep South, kind of resisted bringing in any kind of African American. Up at this point, the Citadel was still all white and all male. However, in 1966, a gentleman by the name of Charles Foster broke the color barrier here at the Citadel, and he became the first African American cadet. And not only did he become the first African American cadet admitted into the Citadel, he was the first to graduate in 1970. His name is not widely recognized or known, and the main reason why is that he was kind of on the tail end of breaking through that barrier. A lot of the other schools in the state had already kind of broken that barrier down, but this year actually celebrates in 2020 the 50th anniversary of Charles Foster's graduation from the Citadel. He was a member of Golf Company. Unfortunately, he did not live a very long life. He had an untimely death back in 1986 after passing away in a house fire down in Dallas, Texas. But he will forever make history for that. The other major part in the Citadel's history, especially more recent history, came in 1995. In 1995, the Citadel welcomed in its first female cadet by the name of Shannon Faulkner. And the way that Shannon Faulkner actually got admitted in, I don't like the word fraud, it was more of just a little bit of misleading, so to speak. Her and her guidance counselor, when she was a senior in high school, wanted to attend the Citadel, and so she left out intentionally all kind of personal pronouns. So therefore, when the application came into the Citadel campus, Shannon, the name was read as a male. And so she was admitted in. Of course, when she showed up, very clearly a female, it went to court. And after a two-year legal battle, it was decided that she would be welcomed in. Now, Shannon Faulkner, while being the first woman admitted into the cadet as a female, lasted about a week. After about a week, she decided that she was going to drop out. But the next year, in 1996, four more women were welcomed in. And of those four, one of them, by the name of Nancy Mace, became the first cadet, female cadet, to graduate from the Citadel in its history. And since that time, women into the Corps. And so Nancy Mace not only went on to earn a business administrative degree here, she graduated magna cum laude, and she currently serves in the South Carolina House of Representatives. And so one of the most sacred places that you can find on the Citadel campus is what's right here. Citadel cadets have fought in every major war and conflict the United States has fought in ever since the Mexican-American War. In fact, in 1917, it was the entire graduating class of the Citadel that decided to enlist and go fight in World War I. And they were the only class in the school's history to do so. And so the class of 1967 decided to raise money and to have this memorial built. And this memorial that we call the War Memorial is dedicated to all of those cadets that fought in those conflicts and gave the ultimate sacrifice, giving their lives for this nation. And so straight here in front of me, we'll take a walk, you will actually see all of the names, the 760 names of these cadets. They're divided into the conflict themselves, and then in addition to that, they are put into no specific order of their names. And as you can see, starting with the Mexican-American War, the war between the states, the Civil War, and that goes all the way over to Operation Iraqi Freedom and Operation Enduring Freedom. And then finally, on the last walls, these four plaques actually outline the entire history of the Citadel as it pertains to these wars. And it's a phenomenal thing to come out and to take a look, to read through all of this history, hearing about stories on and off of the battlefields of these individuals who decided to go into service after graduation. And this is a place that when you come into, it should always be remembered that the freedoms of our country have always been paid through the blood, sweat, and tears of our military personnel and their families. And that is why when you walk into this sacred space, there is only one thing that is asked of you, and it's to speak softly, because you're in the company of heroes. You're in the company of great men and women. So follow me. Let's head around to the very back. Following President Summerall as president of the school came a gentleman by the name of Mark Wayne Clark. And Mark Wayne Clark was president. And when you look at the Citadel's history, especially from the more recent history, Mark Clark really is the individual who was the president during a lot of the sweeping changes to the school's history. In fact, when he passed away, he was given special privilege to actually be buried right here on campus. And he remains the only full body burial to occur on the Citadel campus today. Right behind, of course, you'll see the bell tower. The only other option is that there are cremations that take place and are entered in to the bell tower today. But the only full body burial that has taken place is of President Mark Clark. And so back here, it's kind of a nice quiet spot. I know I've talked a lot and I wanna go ahead and address a couple of questions. So while we're back here, I'll give y'all a second to let y'all start chiming in on some questions. I have Lisa filming, and so she's gonna look through and she's gonna shout out some questions. So we'll give it a few minutes, just take some time. Anything that comes to mind that you wanna know more about the campus, the history, anything, be more than happy to answer questions.
Any famous alumni?
What's that?
Catherine would like to know.
Catherine would like to know about famous alumni. You know, absolutely. And of course, you're talking about famous alumni. You can kind of look at famous alumni depending on who, you know, in terms of the spectrum of who you would consider famous. Going back from the very early years. But, you know, in terms of the ones, I think from a national standpoint, when again, Shannon Faulkner and Nancy Mace were coming in, without a doubt, they made leaps and bounds, a lot of history and waves at the Citadel. And of course, their names became pretty well known across the Citadel's history. Yes, there's absolutely, but of course, it's all in relation to who you would consider famous.
Do women knobs do the exact same thing as the men, aka their hair?
Great question. So by the way, the reason why they're called knobs is actually because, just before I address the women's side of it, so when gentlemen were coming into campus, when they get their head shaved, their heads resembled a doorknob, and that's of course where that term knob came about. When women started coming in, women do not receive that style of haircut. They do get a military cut, but it is not as short as the standard knob haircut.
Paul would said it would be great for you to walk in the gutter of the Avenue of Remembrance and explain why knobs walk there.
Oh yeah, because knobs, we were walking across like the parade deck and grounds. Knobs are not allowed to walk across the parade grounds. They have to keep into the gutter, so to speak. I'll show you that when we get back over there. So I'll finish answering some questions out here and then we'll head back over there. I'll show you that.
Why does the eagle's head on Bond Hall face the parade deck?
That's a great question. I do not know the answer. Do you know the question? The answer to that?
The Overwatch.
The Eagle Overwatch. Yeah. Gotcha. So.
I think that might be all. One more second.
I will say that I got another one.
Deborah Floyd says John Laverne is a famous alumni.
John Laverne is definitely a famous alumni. Infamous alumni.
Notorious.
A lot of words. One of the questions that I have gotten about the campus is about cell phones. Is that, can cadets actually have cell phones? The answer is yes. Cadets, even nobs, are allowed to have cell phones. That changed in 2008. Before 2008, cell phones were not allowed. But the reason why is not from this idea that the kids can't live without their cell phones. It comes from a safety standpoint. Because if you think about 2008, that was right around Virginia Tech. So that was when it became a policy that safety reasons that the students should be able to have their cell phones. And so that's one thing. I've also been asked a lot about what do kind of the rules that get broken a lot out at the campus, what's one of the biggest ones? I would say probably the biggest rule that gets broken more than anything else is going AWOL, is actually leaving campus without permission. But the one thing you have to consider that today, which is vastly different than even 30 years ago, is that the Citadel, there is a number of different clubs and organizations and things that cadets can be a part of. So it may not be because they're AWOL, they might be doing another act. Harder today, I think, to keep track of that. But in terms of punishment, there is absolutely no hazing at the campus. None of that things are confinement, which is essentially when you get stuck to your room during what would otherwise be free time for about 50 minutes. The other one is actually in giving a tour. And what they mean by giving a tour is that you go into your barracks and you basically take your rifle and you just walk around the barracks for a period of about 50 minutes. And so that's another way, that's another form of quote punishment that's often addressed to cadets across the board. And so I get the questions a lot as well coming out here.
Jackie O'Connor wants three of the gates to the War Memorial.
Oh, that's interesting. So they're replicas of another set of gates that's actually located on campus called the Sword Gates. There was when the Sword Gates are some of the most famous gates out of the city of Charleston, a gentleman by the name, and I don't want to misspeak, but Christopher Warner, I believe, that actually designed what was called the Sword Gates. And those Sword Gates, there was a mistake, and he actually made two pair. One was intended for the school, but the other one, because they made an extra pair, got put onto a house on Legree Street, which is now called the Sword Gate House. And so these are not the original Sword Gates, but they are replicas. The other original Sword Gates are found on the Citadel campus. A little bit too far of a walk, though, from where we're standing.
I'm paraphrasing this question, but do people of different religions go to school here, or is it any one particular religion?
Anyone is welcome. All religions are welcome. I wouldn't say there's one definitely more than other. But like I was saying with Summerall, that's why it's a non-denominational chapel. It's not just a Catholic chapel or a Protestant or Episcopal. It's a place that anyone can go into and to worship.
Do you know what percentage of cadets currently enrolled are women today?
That's a good question. Do you know the number?
7%.
Half?
10.
So it's about half?
No.
Oh, sorry. 10. Oh, 10%. I thought you said half percent. 10%. That's a good question. 10%. The half was a little much. Yeah, 10% is a good question. And when it comes to the academic side, because I do want to address this real quickly. Of course, in the very early years, they did not have majors. And so all the cadets would go through the exact same process of learning, same subjects. And not only were they learning math and science, but they were learning some of the humanities. They would learn philosophy and English and history. And it wasn't until about the 20th century that the majors were introduced. And one of the first of the three majors, I believe, were literature, English, and civil engineering. today there's no more departments. There are five schools, all led by a dean. And the five schools, business, education, engineering, social sciences, and then history, or then science and mathematics, are those five schools today. 23 different majors spread across those five schools. And one thing that you often find, which I think is interesting about the Citadel, is that when you look at current enrollment, it's a little over about 2,200 students, and then you have upwards of 800 or so postgraduate in the graduate school here. But that number hasn't really changed over the course of recent history. And the Citadel kind of maintains that number. And so you don't find that, you know, that the Citadel has building more, need to build tremendous more barracks, because they're just bringing, they always wanted to maintain that kind of number for, of course, the purposes of education. Today, though, I will say that if anyone out there, especially a potential student to the Citadel, if you are interested in engineering, the engineering program here at the Citadel has been ranked in the top 25 in the nation for the last 6 years. So it's definitely a great program to be involved in if you ever want to come down to the Citadel. So is there any other questions? So why don't we're going to head a little bit back up this direction.
Wait, there is one more. Mm-hmm. How many Citadel graduates, a percentage, join the military after graduation?
So about 30%. About 30%. It is not a requirement. Citadel cadets, when they go out, many, of course, will return to civilian life. Of course, they can continue on in military life, but it's about 30%.
Do they have to go into a particular branch?
No. Mm-mm. No, they can go into any branch. So. All right, so follow me. Let's head back up a little bit to where, closer to where we got started. Stop right here. So we're going to stop right here. Like I said, we're back right in front of Summerall Chapel. And this has always been a very beloved place, not just for the cadets, to locals. And it's some place that I've always had just a lot of admiration for. But before we actually end this live, I do want to acknowledge just a few people. You know, this is a tour that when we got this offering, it was definitely going to be a new project, something we'd never really done before. And John Laverne, our founder, everything about Bulldog, you know, if it wasn't for his time here at the Citadel, then we wouldn't be Bulldog Tours. And so, of course, you know how special it is. I want to thank Ted Fining, who actually helped. He was our point person here to help this thing get rolling. And I hope that we're doing him proud, the Citadel proud, in everything that we've accomplished with this tour. And like I said, today I just wanted to hit a couple of the highlights. There is so much more history here. We cover much more on the full soul of the Citadel. So once the, you know, things kind of maybe return back to normal and we're able to get this tour started, you know, we definitely encourage you to come out and see us. I also want to thank Lisa Berezny. Lisa was filming this tour for us today. Y'all have seen her on some of the other videos that we've been doing during the quarantine. So I definitely want to say thank you to her as well. And finally, I just want to address the graduating class of 2020. Tomorrow, y'all are going to, of course, be the first class to graduate virtually at this campus. And as John said, that may have not been what you would have imagined a couple of years ago when you came in. But what you have to understand is that when you look at the Citadel's history, it's not the same school that started in 1842. It has grown, it has evolved, and it has adapted. But there are three things that have always stayed the same. honor, duty, and respect. And it is those three values that have always remained at this place, values that you will carry with you for the rest of your life. Tomorrow, you are making history, you are being a part of this place, and you will forever remain part of the great legacy that is the Citadel, the Military College of South Carolina. So thank you guys for joining me today. I really do appreciate your time. Y'all have a wonderful weekend. Congratulations, class 2020, and God bless in your future endeavors.